Very warm welcome to everyone. Respected Secretary DPIT, Sri Anurag Jain, Sri Adil Janvibhai, Chairman QCI, Sri Nandan Nilekani, and all distinguished members of the Advisory Council of Open Network for Digital Commerce, Sri T. Koshi, Chief Advisor of ONDC, officials of the Government of India and state governments, all innovators, startups, and participants in the Startup India Innovation Week, friends from the media, ladies and gentlemen, we are delighted to present the contours of the first ever open network for digital commerce in this event today. As you are aware, Open Network for Digital Commerce is an initiative aiming at promoting open networks for all aspects of exchange of goods and services over digital or electronic networks. It is to be based on open source methodology using open specifications and open network protocols which are independent of any specific platform. And the foundations of ONDC are open protocols, to be emphasized again. And this is for entire aspects in the entire value chain of activities in exchange of goods and services. Similar to what we have, Hypertext Transfer Protocol for exchange, information exchange over internet, or simple mail transfer protocol that we have for exchange of emails. In India, we also have the Unified Payments Interface for exchange of payments. What do we expect ONDC to do? These protocols, which are open, all pervasive, would standardize all operations like cataloging, inventory management, order management, and order fulfillment, entire value chain. So what happens? Small businesses would be able to use any compatible app, any compatible ONDC app, instead of being governed by specific platform-centric policies. And this opens up multiple options to small businesses to be discoverable over the network and conduct their businesses. It will also encourage easy adoption of digital means by those who are not on the digital commerce networks today. The idea of this open network was conceived during April-May 2020. During the first wave of COVID, all government efforts were directed towards provisioning of essential supplies to citizens who were entrapped in containment zones. It was then that we realized the disconnect that exists between online demand of home delivery and availability of online suppliers. From conceptualizing the idea, then in April-May 2020 to January 22, we have covered some distance. ONDC has received its certificate of incorporation as a private sector-led non-profit company on 31st December 2021. A number of established companies have integrated with ONDC and proved the concept of transactions based on protocols over a network which is beyond platforms. As a run-up to the Startup India Innovation Week, we organized an ONDC Grand Hackathon from 7th to 9th January 2020. And the response has been tremendous from innovators. We look forward to looking at those winners, what were the problem statements, and how this can help all other innovators do their businesses. We have a very, very exciting session today. And I now request Mr. Adil Janvibhai, who is the chairman of Quality Council of India, who has incubated this idea at the project management unit that was established at QCI for developing this concept of ONDC. I would request now Mr. Adil Janilbhai, Chairman QCI, to take this forward along with his team at ONDC. Thank you.
Anil, thank you very much. And a warm welcome to the entire startup world, as well as the innovation world and people who are trying to come up with completely new ways of using technology to solve our development issues. I think this is a momentous occasion, and I'm very excited that we have actually got to this point and are about to launch what could be a revolution and breakthrough in how anyone thinks about bringing digital commerce to a large number of enterprises and a very large number of people. So let me start out by saying, Saransh, if you can move the slide, that we have a lot of interest. You know, these days we have a lot of confidence in India about our ability to do what we are calling population scale transformations at startup speed. Many of you who are in the startup environment always talk about the fact that you know, governments can't move as quickly. But I think in this case, we're trying to do the best of both, which is get startup speed as well as at government scale. And we are confident about doing this because in the last few years, India has led the way in coming up with technology breakthroughs that allow us to do this, to get benefits to a large number of citizens, et cetera. So for example, UPI was launched and has very quickly become one of the largest financial transaction products in the world. And it was really developed in India, and it has worked, and it has democratized access to the financial world. Obviously, everyone is aware of Aadhaar. I don't need to mention that. But if you look at Ayushman Bharat and what Ayushman Bharat is trying to do in terms of healthcare, NSDC is trying to do in skilling, what we are trying to do in employment, in many other places, the use of open platforms, protocols, open technology has energized the startup ecosystem to come up with many, many solutions because everybody can get access to everyone. So the first message I'd like to give is, this is a breakthrough approach, but it's something that we are now more confident of doing in India, having seen many population scale digital transformations at startup speed. Can we go to the next page, please? If you look at India's digital commerce market, while it has grown dramatically, and all of you, of course, are members of this, we should also keep in mind that as far as the larger population goes, of MSMEs and people using it, we are still in the early days of this breakthrough. And the purpose of doing something like this is to accelerate and democratize access to digital commerce. It would be great to get every, you know, just as almost every single MSME has a place where they do business and they have products that they sell or make or services that they provide, that they should be thinking about digital in the same breath. That should be just a natural thing to do. And if can we get a vast number of MSMEs in India to engage in digital commerce, a very small proportion do it, and we'd like to get to a point where everybody does it. So this in a sense brings capability to everyone, to every retailer, to every MSME. Secondly, while a large number of people are doing this, are using digital commerce, it's still a relatively small percentage compared to other countries like South Korea and China have achieved. And the idea of this is, in a sense, putting in place the infrastructure to allow this to grow dramatically. Right? And finally, while the reach of digital commerce has reached large cities and towns, the very small cities and rural areas, the penetration is still lower. And the purpose of this is to try and, again, accelerate access to everyone. So this is to the great advantage of every customer, every citizen, and every trader, every MSME. Let's go to the next page, please. So the idea, as Anil talked about it, is to make digital commerce inclusive and accessible through an open network so that every buyer and seller can transact online no matter what, you know, no matter where they are and what medium they use to get digitally visible. In that sense, it's a great democratizer. ONDC is by the market, for the markets. You all have all heard about this before, so I'm not going to go into this much more and explain in great detail. But essentially, all parts of the value chain will be able to participate. But I'd like to stress two parts, which is this is a private company that's not for profit, because we believe that this is a public good that should be had for all. And it is not under the control of anyone. It, of course, has a lot of support from the government because this is a public good. But this really is set up as a private Section 8 company. We have a lot of investors who have invested in it, not to make money, but because this is a great private good. And we are looking forward to allowing everybody to participate in this as quickly as possible, including payment partners, logistics partners, technology service providers, startups, and large and medium small merchants. It has, as we have said earlier, quite a lot of people are very excited about participating in this. And to date, we have had almost 15 enterprises who are willing, who have given an indication of being the core partners to start funding this enterprise. And I think we are reaching a point which is where we all want to be, which is everyone's knocking on the doors of ONDC to participate. I think we don't have to go out and ask people to do it. Everybody wants to do it. So I think in terms of the financial capability, in terms of the organizational capability, I think we have launched, we are in good shape. We've got now a team at ONDC that can drive it. It's all been done in record time. And I think our next step is to get all of you in the development space, in the startup space, to really participate and help us drive this to every retailer, every MSME, and every citizen of India. I will now hand it over to Koshi to take us through some more details on exactly what this is. Thank you.
Thank you, Anil, and thank you, Adil, and dignitaries present, and all the innovators and the industry veterans who are all watching this momentous occasion for ONDC, and thank you for being there. Anil and Adil explained to you the context and the big picture, so I'll go a little more detail, and later we will arrange to have a demo of how it works for you to understand that we are going forward and for you to understand that we are almost ready to go live. So come to the next slide. So we are all familiar with e-commerce, most of us are, and we have been using it for a few years, at least in the big cities and towns. And we have some few large entities giving completely integrated solution in a fantastically brilliant way. We are all beneficiaries of that. But one, what they do is they will give you the comprehensive solution, integrated solution on one side from the seller, on the other side, the buyer. If I'm a buyer, I can use an application provided by a platform to buy anything of what I want, most of it what I want. They will connect to the sellers who are already a part of the same platform and make it available. So there are a few large such platforms making these facilities available to a large cross-section. As Adil said, it is still a small cross-section of people who are using it. But we want to make this available to the large, as of large cross-section of our country, practically to everybody. Today, the penetration is less than 10%, and we want to make it to near to 100% sometime in the not so far away future. And to make that happen, this few enterprises alone will not be sufficient. We need to have participation big and small industries. And in a platform approach, we have a challenge, is that if you want to set up the whole comprehensive integrated service, it can be expensive, it can be very complex, and it might be very demanding. Whereas we have a large number of enterprises and people capable of taking up individual components of this trade. That's why, as Anil explained, we, the team ONDC under the aegis of DPIT, conceptualized a fundamental shift in the way the solutions are architected in e-commerce. What is a fundamental shift? Two simple words: interoperability and unbundling. Interoperability means any platform should be able to talk to any other platform. Not the restriction that the seller and buyer has to be in the same platform, which is in certain way for certain clients, it is very good. But to make it really broad-based, if everybody can practically communicate with each other, you can make a big difference. And secondly, like I said earlier, we should enable different innovations, different people who are capable of handling components of trade to be a part of the story, not just somebody who can do everything together. So that's why the ONDC team brought this idea of an open protocol to make all platforms interoperable. Come to the next slide, please. If I just go a little more specific, on the left side, you will see current way of platform. You have few platforms. Each of them have their own buyers and each of the sellers. But now once the ONDC up and running and smooth, we will have the picture on the right side. How does it work? The buyers will have many buyer platforms. The beauty is all the buyer platform, any of the buyer platform can reach any of the sellers in any of the seller platform, interoperability. And that's a big difference. So it also opens up enormous opportunity for innovations and new business and new player to come. Today, if you look at, there are many entities who have a cohort of their own consumers to whom they're giving different services. It could be telecom companies, it could be payment wallet companies, anybody, or it could be search companies. But they have no connections or linkage or interest or capability to go and get the seller, establish a seller platform. Today, they cannot be in e-commerce and in the service because they also have to take the effort to get the sellers on board. Now, tomorrow when the ONDC is up and running, the buyer, anybody who can manage a set of buyers through a digital media and application can be ONDC enabled and be there in the net. And they can reach across to any seller. Same is the story that is going to happen even to the seller side. Now, there could be different entities who are servicing digital services to many small, medium, and large enterprises. Today, if they have to make their clients digitally visible, they can definitely do it with ease. But the problem is, how do they get their buyers? They have to again go and accumulate their buyer, which can be an expensive effort. So that's why if they can make their applications or platforms ONDC enabled, they suddenly get an opportunity to expose themselves to a large set of buyers coming from all the other buying applications. It is a fundamental shift. It's almost like a magic wand, which is changing the way the commerce is working. And that is going to bring in humongous amount of innovation. Innovation, in fact, the hackathon that we announced, which is practically announced only 2-3 weeks ago, show humongous response of really smart people from big companies on one side to small school students on the other side came together and said, we can contribute one component. So if I just jokingly says, when I saw some really smart youngsters coming with brilliant ideas, I thought about the squirrel in the Ramayana. Anybody in this large enterprise, everybody can contribute, and that contribution come together to make this big bridge connecting the buyer and seller, which is what Anil was explaining in the beginning. And we were excited about the quality of what came out in the hackathon. And we believe it's only a start. You'll see a lot more innovation that is happening, which will change the way the sellers do the business, change the way the consumers interact and do the digital commerce. Imagine somebody like a small, somebody, a mom and pop, somebody who can make good cakes at home. They don't know anything else but to make a cake. A seller application might be available ready-made, like today we make HTML page to make ourselves visible, to say that cake is available on the ONDC network. And payment systems will make arrangement for the payments, the logistics provider will provide for the logistics, and so on and so forth. So that is how the participation can very, very significantly increase. And that is the vision of ONDC, and that's what we are trying to. Come to the next slide, please. So if you look at So that way, if I just summarize all what three of us have said about ONDC, if you first, I'll say what it is not an application or a platform. It's not a new platform being set up by the government. Absolutely not. It's a private entity. It's not a single application. It's not a platform at all, but it's an open network where platforms and solutions come together and collaborate and help each other and the consumer and the seller. It is not a central intermediary. It's not a central switch where everybody will have to link up to. And it's not a regulator. It's an enabler. It's a service provider. Regulation and lawmaking is that of the legislator and the executive. This is a service provider. Now, it will, it will be an enabler for e-commerce expansion all across the country, as Anil and Adil will explain. It is going to bring, as I said earlier, broad-based innovation. And at the end of it, like I said, it's a market and community-led initiative. Come to the next slide, please. So I'm just going to arrange for a demo. You know, what is this picture doing with ONDC? Just to tell you what are we, where we are today. Now, we are all familiar with how the automobiles are made. First, all the individual components get made. It's all fitted to a chassis. And on the top of it, we have all the beautiful enabling facilities for you and I to use as a users. Are we ready with a completely finished product as of today? No. But we are, what we are going to, we are almost ready is a chassis, almost ready to be a complete car. So I'm going to do a demonstration. I'm not going to simply show you some code and protocol. I'm not also going to tell you the complete beautified customer experience, because there's going to be a lot of finish going to come. But I'm going to show that multiple entities who have established their own applications for support the buyer, to support the seller, to support us all, logistics from different entities. It is not a PowerPoint show. It is the applications, the barebone application prepared by we just selected three companies who are fully ready in that sense, and enabling a transaction across this multi-sector. And with that, so we will demonstrate how it happens. So you will be able to get an idea how somebody can search, for a product using the buyer application. And then how a logistic company will deliver what they really want with the right choice they have made with respect to the product, the supplier, and the pricing. Over to you, Vibhor. To Sharansh, can you just run the video?
Hello, everyone. Today, we'll be seeing a demo of a cascaded transaction in ONDC through the retail and logistics networks. In this transaction, PhonePe is the buyer side app, the seller side app is coincidentally called Seller App, and the logistics provider is Goodbox. Today we're doing this demo from the customer's perspective on a buyer side app. So let's say that I'm a user and I want some groceries from my local store. For this, I'll go to the PhonePe buyer side app, which is connected to ONDC. And here I'll go to the search option and search for some chicken using the app. So let's do this. Let's go to the search option. And here I'll search for some chicken. And now let's see the kind of results we get. It's taking a bit to load, but let's wait. Oh, so here we have the results. And so what happened was my search request was sent to an ONDC gateway and broadcast to all seller side apps in the retail network, which are in my location. And I see chicken items from retailers connected to different seller side apps. I can choose any chicken item, say in this case from a merchant Chili's connected to ONDC through the seller side app called Seller App PTE, which also provides free home delivery, by the way. So I choose a few items from this merchant and add them to my cart. After adding these items to my cart, I can see the total for my order. And on the top, you can also see the order has been verified, which means it has been updated in real time with price quote, inventory, and offers from the merchant. And since Chili's only accepts cash on delivery for ONDC, so this option has been defaulted. And since I'm happy with this, I'll proceed and send a request to check out and confirm my order. And now the customer won't see this on the buy side app, but in the background, the following steps take place. The merchant confirms the order on his seller side app, in this case from Seller App PTE, and I get a confirmation that the order has been placed successfully. Now, as soon as I'd initialized the checkout and confirmation for my order, the seller side app broadcasts a request for available delivery agents for this order, again through the ONDC network, to logistics providers. In this case, Goodbox, a logistics provider, accepts the request for a delivery agent. After my order is confirmed by the merchant, it goes ahead and confirms its order with the logistics provider, in this case, Goodbox. And so my order has been confirmed by Goodbox, and I'll wait for Goodbox to assign a delivery agent so that I can start tracking my order. And I will be able to track my order through ONDC. And please note that the buy side app PhonePe will show the live tracking status of a delivery agent from the logistics provider Goodbox via the seller side app, in this case, the seller app PTE. So I can start tracking my order now. And Goodbox picked up my order from the merchant, who sent me a notification saying that the order is underway. And now I can see that the Goodbox delivery agent has been assigned and the order has also been dispatched. Wow, so quick. And here on the map, I can see the live location status of the delivery agent, and soon my order will be delivered to me. So that's how we make a transaction using ONDC.
Thank you. You see, the customer experience is as good as you're already familiar. They're only creating a network behind for people to come together and make it happen. Vibhor, now can I hand it over to you?
Hi, everyone. I'm Meenakshi. We will be presenting the awards for the Grand Hackathon ceremony now. So welcome to the ONDC Grand Hackathon Award Announcement Ceremony. Like I said, I'm Meenakshi.
And I'm Vibhor, and we'll take you through this award session.
ONDC has been building a great community by adding more participants and volunteers to it. To accelerate the implementation of ONDC and encourage participation from the wider ecosystem, we have held exciting events in the last 1 month. On the 7th, 8th, and 9th of January, along with Startup India, ONDC organized a grand hackathon. The hackathon had two streams, integration and innovation, and was open to all innovators, startups, and e-commerce companies. To deepen the understanding of ONDC among the participants, we hosted 4 masterclasses, which were attended by 329 participants.
The ONDC Grand Hackathon event witnessed participation from 131 teams, consisting of 243 members. There were 67 teams in the integration stream and 64 teams in the innovation stream, solving 14 challenges.
We would like to thank everyone for participating with such enthusiasm.
We had an amazing and eminent jury evaluating the submissions. The jury included Anu Narasimhan, faculty IIT Bombay School of Entrepreneurship, Nitin Mishra, partner Ernst & Young and ex-CEO GSTN Network, Sanjeev Gupta, Principal Technical Architect, DCS1 Singapore, and Sanjay Jain, partner Bharat Innovation Fund. And without further delay, we are pleased to announce the results.
Beginning with ONDC Grand Hackathon Innovation Stream, in the first challenge, the participants were expected to enable digitization of catalogs that can be easily integrated by any participant into their app for the ONDC network. This included defining a schema for at least 1,000 items using text, voice, or image input, or a combination of these, with digitization of at least 100 items in under 30 minutes.
And the winner of challenge one is Framework. The runner-up of challenge one goes to Growth Falcons. Congratulations, teams.
Congratulations, teams. For the next challenge, apologies, I think there's a special mention.
Can we go back to the earlier slide, please? Earlier slide. Yeah, thank you.
All right, moving on to the second challenge, which was to enable Indic language support for apps in the ONDC network so that it becomes a mainstream language for digital commerce in India. This entailed developing an intuitive interface that accepts input using text or voice or a combination of both implementing an algorithm for collation, and creating an open standard reusable software?
For this one, we had joint winners for challenge 2, which is Growth Falcons and ThoughtSwarm. Thank you.
Congratulations to the winners. The third challenge was to enable an online conversational interface that provided an immersive user experience and is different from the point and click based and mobile app interfaces. This should guide buyers who are not tech savvy to provide their input through natural language speech or text or a combination of both to simulate a digital commerce transaction. This should be reusable as a mobile app as well.
And the winner for challenge 3 is Sahaya, and the runner up for challenge 3 is Growth Falcons. Congratulations.
Congratulations to the winners. Coming to the fourth challenge, which was to enable intelligent searches for different buyer apps in the ONDC network so that there is better discoverability of seller catalogs. The participants had to include items in various sectors of retail, including but not limited to groceries, hyperlocal retail, food and beverage, fashion, etc.
And the winner for challenge 4 is Growth Falcons. Congrats, Growth Falcons.
Congrats, Growth Falcons. Coming to the fifth challenge. The fifth challenge was to enable dynamic pricing for small retailers and merchants so that they can get the best market price for their products and services. The participants had to create a dynamic pricing model for a domain that accepts inputs such as weather, market data feeds, supply and demand in specific locations, quantity in inventory, etc., to determine the optimal price for an item.
The winner for challenge 5 is Omni. Congrats, Omni.
Congratulations to Omni. The sixth challenge was to enable small retailers, kirana stores, and similar vendors to order optimal quantities of items to reduce wastage and inventory costs. This required participants to create a model for non-deterministic inventory management to minimize the operational costs related to ordering and moving goods. This should consider different variables in the retail supply chain, such as demand patterns, costs, delivery times, cycle times, etc.
And the winner for challenge 6 is Alme. Congrats, team Alme.
Congratulations to the winners. Coming to the seventh challenge, the challenge required participants to enable small retailers and logistic providers to optimize their delivery costs along a given set of locations based on specific criteria such as time taken, distance covered, etc.
And the winner for challenge 7 is Goodbox. Congrats, team Goodbox.
The eighth challenge was to enable buyer and seller apps to provide delivery tracking using easy to use and maintain open source maps. The participants had to develop an open standards based reusable software component that provides functionality for tracking on open source maps.
And the winner for challenge 8 is Samsung. Congrats, team Samsung.
Congratulations to team Samsung. The ninth challenge was to create and maintain a distributed ledger of open data in ONDC that sources events at different levels of granularity from different nodes of the network, aggregates the data by applying mathematical transform, and synchronizes the resultant data across the nodes of the network. The design was to consider at least 1 million nodes.
And the winner of challenge 9 is Divay. Congrats, team Divay.
Congratulations to the winners. Moving on to the next challenge, challenge 10 was to create e-commerce solutions for the decentralized web.
We thank team Divay for the submission in this challenge.
Thank you, team Divay. Challenge 11 was to propose enhancements to backend protocol specification.
We would like to thank team Finarcane for contributing to the backend community.
Coming to the integration stream, the first scenario was for the participants to execute a complete retail transaction using a buyer app and seller app, resulting in order confirmation.
While 15 teams completed scenario 1, the first one to do so were Team Framework and Humby Online. Congratulations, winners.
The second scenario was to execute a complete retail transaction using a buyer app and seller app, resulting in order confirmation and fulfillment by any one logistics provider.
While 9 teams completed the scenario 2, the first one to do so was seller app and Goodbox. Congrats, winners.
Congratulations to the winners. In our last scenario, the participants had to execute a complete retail transaction using a buyer app, more than one seller app, resulting in order confirmation and fulfillment by more than one logistics provider.
While we received 2 submissions for this challenge, the jury felt that they did not comply with the requirements of the challenge and hence no winners in this particular category.
We would like to take this opportunity to congratulate the winners of our ONDC integration sprint that was held in December 2021. In the first challenge, participants had to simulate real-world scenarios of transactions on ONDC connected in a decentralized mode across retail and logistics.
Congratulations to Growth Falcons and GoFrugal.
Congratulations to the winners. In the second challenge, participants had to simulate a full trip cascaded multi-domain transaction across buyers, sellers, and logistics domains on ONDC.
The teams made history as we recorded the first ever multi-domain cascaded round trip transaction. This is the first of its kind ever on an open network using an open protocol. Congrats to both Falcons and Goodbox for winning the first prize and GoFrugal for the runners up. Before we move forward, I would also want to mention we have a special jury recognition. A submission was made by school students Vedant Kulkarni and Siddhant Kulkarni from Pune. They created an online catalog that can be created and updated by anyone using their voice. Their choice of technology, algorithms, the use of clean US designs shows a sense of maturity and capability that is worthy of recognition. A jury was particularly impressed with the submission and wanted to encourage both of them. A special reward of Rs 50,000 is sponsored by a jury member Sanjeev Gupta for the student geniuses. Thanks to both Vedant Kulkarni and Siddhant Kulkarni for participating in the hackathon.
Congratulations to the students. With that, we would like to end the award ceremony. A special thanks to Team Startup India for being a co-host to this event and supporting us through this journey.
We would also like to acknowledge our event sponsor, Zoho Corporation, for their contribution and committing to this mission. With this, we come to an end of the ONDC Grand Hackathon Award Ceremony. Thank you, everyone. I will now hand it over back to Anil Ji.
Sir, you are not audible.
Thanks, Vibor. Thank you very much. This is exciting. We have seen the kind of challenges that were thrown at them and the young innovators and mature companies who have come up with such lovely replies to them. It is now time for me. It is a privilege for me to invite Sri Nandan Nilekani to give his keynote address on what is his perspective on open network for digital commerce. Mr. Nandan Nilekani, please.
Thank you, Anil ji, and it's really a terrific pleasure and privilege to be here at this ONDC event as part of the Startup Innovation Week that DPIIT is organizing. I am really excited to be here. I'm a member of the advisory council along with other distinguished members, and I really believe ONDC is an idea whose time has come. To give you some background, I thought I'll speak about how India has always been a leader in digital transformation at population scale. India has been on this journey of digital transformation at population scale for a decade now, and huge parts of our economy and social activity have been transformed by technology. One example is, of course, Aadhaar, which has reached 1.3 billion people, which is at the foundational identity for all Indians. Today, the Aadhaar system, which is designed at population scale for high volume, low cost transaction, does 50 million authentications a day and 5 million eKYCs a day, and is at the root of many, many foundation for many, many other applications. For example, India runs the world's largest DBT program, where 700 million people have Aadhaar-linked bank accounts. Our secretary, Anurag Jain, was the joint secretary in the Department of Financial Services in the days when they rolled out the Jan Dhan program. So he knows, and he's been a key instrument in that transformation. And thanks to the fact that we have 700 million Aadhaar-linked bank accounts and the Jan Dhan bank account opening initiative, India runs the world's largest digital benefit transfer system in the world, the DBT, where few hundred thousand crores have moved effortlessly, automatically, in real time, into people's bank accounts. This is, again, the kind of technology that India has built. And it is not just about crediting the money into the bank accounts. India also has a unique system called the Aadhaar-enabled payment system, which allows millions of people to withdraw money from their bank account in the safety and convenience of their village. They can go to a business correspondent. We have few hundred thousand business correspondents in India today. Go to a neighborhood Kirana store, just put their finger on the device, withdraw money, and the Kirana store will hand over money to the customer from their bank account and debit their account and credit the Kirana's account. And this system does 90 million transactions a month of 25,000 crores. That means 25,000 crores is being withdrawn by people around the country effortlessly, thanks to the digital rails that India has laid. Then, of course, we have something which we all talk about, which is UPI, the Unified Payment Interface. And many of the ideas we have in ONDC are modeled on the success of UPI. UPI, again, was a system designed by NPCI, which has been at the forefront of payment transformation in India. UPI was conceived about 8 years back. The first launch of UPI happened in February of 2016. And then there was a final launch of the product, February 2015. And finally, in May 2016, we had the launch of UPI. And UPI was designed to be a next generation payment system, which gave complete interoperability between banks and digital platforms and allowed for all kinds of innovation to come. And in October of 2016, this platform was only doing 100,000 transactions. And then in November of 2016, when the government chose to do the demonetization, the withdrawal of certain currencies, the government chose to take UPI as the flagship platform along with RuPay for digital transformation and digital payments. The Prime Minister himself launched the Bheem application, which was a very simple user-oriented application for people to do payments on the phone. And now UPI Bheem, as it is called, has become a world leader, and last month alone did 4.5 billion transactions valued at more than $100 billion. And therefore, it's again a great example of success in payments and so on. And then there are many other platforms. India has a common platform for taxes, for indirect taxes through GST, a common platform for direct taxes. And also another important thing is the account aggregator platform, which has been sponsored and led by the RBI, which is fundamentally going to transform credit to small businesses, because now they can use their digital footprint and access credit by using the data from many systems, giving it in a secure manner to a lender who will then decide to give them a loan. So we are now with the AA launch, which happened in September of last year. We are now, India is now building the infrastructure for democratizing credit at population scale, both for consumers as well as for small businesses. Another example of our population scale systems, which is not that well recognized, is FASTag. FASTag is the system used by our travelers on our highways to automatically pay the toll when they drive through a toll gate. This system has had a huge productivity benefit for the economy. So when a truck is going from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, it can just drive through the toll gate and automatically the toll is deducted from the bank account or wallet attached to the RFID tag, which is on the truck. And this system has been, again, a spectacular success. And today, this system is doing a few hundred million transactions. And the daily collection on FASTag is 100 crores. So something like 40,000 crores a year is the annual collection of toll money. This has made our road infrastructure more viable. It has allowed the government to monetize these assets and recycle the capital into new road building. And therefore, it's again an example of the use of technology. And the RFID tag-based system has got is really a platform again, and it can be used for other applications. I recently noticed that there is a startup that has been funded, which will do parking charges using RFID tags. So which means that in the parking lot, you just drive in, and based on the number of hours you park in the parking lot and what time of the day it is dynamically calculates the parking charge and you will get debited. And this has been a well-funded startup. So all these things are happening. And then there are many, many other examples. There's the Ayushman Bharat Digital Mission, which has been launched. It is being led by the National Health Authority. Another advisory council member, Ram Sevak Sharma, leads that. And this is going to transform healthcare by enabling a unified health interface, just like a unified payment interface, which allows all these, all the different health providers to interoperate seamlessly. Again, the Ayushman Bharat Digital Health Mission has been launched by the Prime Minister, and a lot of work is going on to make a change there. And then there are many, many other examples of these kind of large-scale systems and platforms that India has built. And these platforms are designed at population scale. These platforms are designed for a very high volume, billions of transactions, designed for low or no cost, and designed for a small sachet size. So they're very, very inclusive systems that have been designed. Now, why is it that India has been so successful in making these platforms happen? The reason is because many, many things have come together. The first, of course, is there has been a tremendous government commitment to using technology for development. The Prime Minister has talked about TechAid, or this being the technology decade. And he is the first to ask why technology is not being used for solving a particular problem. And in every one of these initiatives, we have had extremely high government support. Aadhaar took off because there was great support from governments. When Prime Minister Modi came in 2014, I met him and he was very supportive of Aadhaar. He has become a huge champion, and that continues. And in the case of NPCI again, in November of 2016, after the withdrawal of certain currency notes, there was a big push, which, as I said, which is why the transactions went up from 100,000 to 4.5 billion in about 5 years. And this government support is there everywhere. In the case of FASTag, there's tremendous support from the minister, Mr. Gadkari. So, and so on. So wherever there is one fundamental requirement to make all these large scale systems work is government commitment from both government and from the bureaucracy who are part of that. So I think that is something which is there. The second thing is it has to address a market or social need. In the case of UPI, India needed a low-cost transaction platform so that somebody on the street selling vegetables from a cart should be able to make payments. In the case of Aadhaar, we have to solve the problem of millions of Indians not having identity, and as they started migrating, being unable to prove who they are, whether it was to board a train or bus or to get a job. For FASTag, the reason was that there was a lot of leakage of money at the highways, and people were not paying, and therefore a lot of infrastructure projects that had been privatized, the investors were not getting a return on that. For GST, it was because India wanted to have a single market. Earlier, we had every country, every state had its own sales tax or VAT system, and GST created a single market and unified the tax platform. For health, we have had the need to provide large-scale insurance through Ayushman Bharat, and now we want, and the pandemic has shown the need for health. We saw the vaccination drive. One part of the vaccination success, obviously, was the fact that India has great vaccine manufacturing companies like Serum and Bharat Bio and others. The other part is that we built an extraordinary platform like Cowin, which has allowed everybody in the country to register and get the vaccination. And there is the DIVOC vaccination certificate. So recently, there was a friend of mine from Chicago who came to Bombay. And the security guard at the hotel asked him to show his vaccination certificate. And he showed them a piece of paper. And the security guard said, yeah, aapke paas digital nahi hai kya? So that is the level of reach that we have, where even the security guard has understood that we have a digital vaccination certificate with a QR code. So there has to be a market or social need. The third important requirement is there has to be a technology which is there and built. So in every one of these cases, there's some amazing technology which has been built. It's been built at population scale. It's been built using the latest techniques of open source and the latest developments of AI and so on. In fact, one of the biggest use of AI is actually Aadhaar, where the authentication is using AI. So India has built all that. In the case of UPI, again, entirely built on an open source stack by NPCI. And NPCI is, again, a very forward-looking organization. And now they're using the UPI stack for other. So all the other payment systems in NPCI, like AEPS or IMPS, all sit on top of the same software stack. So these are all very, very sophisticated, high-end things. We have people like Dr. Pramod Verma, who has been working for the country for the last 10 years in designing these architectures and so on. So you require world-class technology. Then you need institutions for implementation. For Aadhaar, we had the UIDAI, which has had a series of amazing IAS officers as the CEOs. For NPCI, we have had the extraordinary company, NPCI, started by RBI, with a dynamic CEO in Mr. Dilip Basbe. For the AA system, we have a great support from the Reserve Bank of India, which has taken this as a very important step forward, and so on. So institutions are required to actually execute on this. Institutions either which are independent or within the government, like Anurag drove the Jandan program when he was at DFS. And then you need to develop systems in a way where the government provides or enables infrastructure, but innovators can sit on top of it and build great applications. And that is what we are seeing today. Banks, for example, new payment banks have come up, new private banks have come up. They're all using Aadhaar eKYC and all that. When Reliance launched Jio, they were able to ramp up to 100 million users on the Jio platform, in part because they used Aadhaar eKYC to do the KYC for giving the mobile connections. So it has enabled innovation in many ways. I talked about the company that has come up for parking in payments. We have seen a massive explosion of fintech companies, all of whom are sitting on top of this infrastructure that we have. So we need to have the innovators And that becomes very important. So therefore, if any idea which is of this type has to succeed, it has to satisfy these four or five things. It needs to have strong government commitment. It needs to address a market and social need. It needs to have world-class technology. It needs to have an institution to anchor and promote this. And it needs dynamic innovators to embrace it. All these things are required to make it a success. Now, where does ONDC fit in this? I believe the Open Network for Digital Commerce meets all the criteria for the next revolution and disruption in India. First, we have dynamic government commitment. We have seen terrific commitment from the minister, Mr. Piyush Goyal, whom I've known very well for his dynamism and entrepreneurial energy. And he has been at the forefront of making this happen. We have people like Anurag Jain, who is a veteran of technology transformation in Madhya Pradesh. He led the creation of the earliest CSCs 15 years back when I first met him. He had implemented the first CSCs in Madhya Pradesh. We have Anil Agarwal as the AS, whose response is faster than anyone I've met in the private sector. You call him up and he replies within 1 minute. So this is amazing. So there's amazing energy in the system. And then we have people like my friend Adil Zainulbai, who as heading the QCI is playing a big role. And he comes again, he's an old friend and from my days at IIT Bombay and McKinsey, and now helping the government on QCI. So we have a fantastic commitment from the government, and I know the Prime Minister's office themselves care deeply about this. So first requirement is we have the government commitment. The second requirement is a market and social need. Now this has become very, very important because especially the pandemic has demonstrated that e-commerce is going to be a way of life for Indians. So we are going to see in the coming years a massive migration of more and more people ordering online through their devices. There'll be more devices, there'll be more accessible devices, there'll be millions of people using that, and there will be more ordering of online. India has a trillion dollar retail economy. And even if 10 to 20% of that goes online, we are talking about $100 to $200 billion doing online. Now, e-commerce is not a winner take all economy. It is not about, unlike advertising, unlike social media or search and those kind of areas where you have, one or two players have all the action. In the case of e-commerce, there will be multiple players, and we have to create a way for the small entrepreneur, the small merchant, the small seller to compete in this new e-commerce world in equitable ways. So if we are going to increase the proportion of e-commerce to total commerce to even 20% of our retail business, we're talking about $200 billion. And therefore, we owe it to our millions of sellers and millions of small retailers to give them an easy way to participate in this new emerging high growth digital commerce. So there's a huge market and social need for this. The third thing is that we need an institution, and the system has been very farsighted in setting up the ONDC as a company, a non-profit Section 8 company, very similar to NPCI, which is a non-profit Section 8 company owned by banks, and now this owned by actually more than banks. And ONDC also will have a large number of public-spirited shareholders. And I'm told that there's enormous interest in investing in NPCI, in ONDC. So ONDC will act as the non-profit public-spirited institution that will orchestrate the interactions of this new ONDC, this open network, and put in place the ground rules, the network participant rules, the obligations, the counterparty rules, how to deal with complaints, dispute resolution, and so on. So somebody has to perform that role, and the ONDC will support that role. It's very important to realize that this is something which requires great technology. I said in every one of our earlier successful things in India, technology has been at the root of it. And I'm aware that the technology platform is really, it's more protocols. It's not even technology, it's protocols. And the protocols that are being designed for ONDC are best in class and will allow a wide set of network participants to interoperate and contribute, where different sellers can participate and reach different buyers. Different buyers can reach different sellers. So discovery is done through this interoperability. And this is something which, so it will have top class protocols and so on. And it has the advantage of a well thought through advisory council. I mentioned my friend Adil. Adil is a member of that. Dilip Asbe, who led NPCI, is a member of that. Mr. Ram Sevak Sharma, the CEO of NHA, is a member of that. I'm a member of that. Anjali Bansal is a member of that. Rajgopal is a member of that. The CAIT person, Mr. Khandelwal, is there. So it's a very, very good, of course, we have the officials. So it's a very, very good group of people. We have Arvind Gupta, who's also been a leader in this space. So we have a lot of people who've done this before. So these are not people who are just theoreticians. These are people who are practitioners, who have actually built some of the systems that we have. We have Koshi as an advisor. Koshi has been building population system for 30 years. He was part of the first team which built India's dematerialized NSDL, as well as the National Pension System. So really all the people who over the years have participated in this are part of this. So that's also very important. And then of course, we will want to have the market participants. And I believe that this is going to be fundamental to the market participants. And I really hope that all the market participants will realize that here's something where the need is very large, where government is committed, where there's an institution to make it happen, where there are technology leaders who have done this before, where there is great technology. All of these things are coming together. And therefore, I would urge all market innovators to be part of that. We have already seen the tremendous response that the hackathon got. I just saw the exciting thing, and you know, two 15-year-olds or 13-year-olds are building apps. That is the future of India, and I think we are showing the way there. Now, why is this going to be so important? Basically, because there are four or five mega trends that are shaping this thing. First, as I mentioned earlier, and the pandemic has only accelerated that, is movement from offline to online commerce. And if you only get 20% of $1 trillion, that's $200 billion of retail. So the movement from offline to online. The second is the movement from the Western model of advertising-led internet to the Indian model of transaction-led internet. In the West, the last 20 years, the rise of the internet was fueled by digital advertising. That's how the big players like Google and Facebook make money, because advertising in the US was a few hundred billion dollar revenue, which started migrating to digital. That's how they were able to make money. But in India, the digital advertising is very small. It's only $2 to $3 billion out of the total $10 billion advertising revenue of India. And therefore, India will be a transaction-led economy for internet. And things like UPI, which is very high volume, zero cost, very simple to use, will drive that. And therefore, we have to take advantage of the fact that India will be a transaction-led internet economy. And that is also part of the trend that ONDC will play on. The third is the movement of customers from department store to doorstep, where people have got used to, especially in the pandemic, to get delivery home. And delivery home is not just about big platforms delivering it to home. Today, every retail Kirana store has a home delivery. You can pick up the phone and call up the guy and he'll have it delivered to you at home. So delivery at home is now become ubiquitous everywhere. And then a very big move that is happening is India is going from unbranded to branded. So what we're seeing is we are going to see the rise of a lot more brands in every part, whether it's you'll have branded rice, you'll have branded soap, you'll have branded face cream. So you're going to see massive brands, and all of them will want access to consumers, and all of them will work with creators and all to, you know, create the story on their products. So this massive branding is going to happen, and every one of those new brands will want access to the market. The fourth is the modernization of India's small traders. I think we have millions of small traders, and thanks to technology, thanks to startups, thanks to GST, they're doing everything digitally now, and they are now ready for participating in this ecosystem. And finally, India's transition from prepaid to postpaid. The mobile revolution of India happened thanks to prepaid phones. The big genius of the telecom companies was they came up with a way to get millions of subscribers and got them to pay in advance 5 rupees, 10 rupees to get mobile talk time. But now with account aggregator, OKN, and all these other platforms, credit at scale is going to happen. And therefore, both the consumers who are going to be buyers on the system through things like buy now, pay later kind of credit, or the suppliers who will get access to supply credit using the account aggregator system and leveraging the OKN protocol, suddenly India will go from next 10 years from prepaid to postpaid. And all this means that everybody has a chance. The suppliers who are producing products will get access to a whole new set of consumers through the ONDC. The small retailer can participate on an equal footing in ONDC. And if he sees a particular request for a product, he can say, look, I just live 500 meters from your house, I will deliver it to you. And therefore, the small retailer, the Kirana store, can participate in the retail transaction and get things delivered. A whole set of delivery companies will come up who will specialize in becoming efficient deliverers, quick commerce, this, that. There'll be a huge number of interfaces. People will be able to use voice. They'll be able to speak in Indian languages. They'll be able to do all kinds of things so that it'll become easy for the Indian to access this e-commerce platform. And those innovations will happen independent of the supply chain. And then you'll see brand aggregators coming. We are seeing many new brand aggregators, Mensa brands and many others, Global Bees and so on. And they're going to aggregate brands and they will want access to consumers. So all these things are happening today. And this will lead to a massive explosion enabled by ONDC. So I just want to make it clear that number one, ONDC will happen. The conditions are there. The right people are there. The government commitment is there. We will make it happen. It is a unified effort of government, public-spirited individuals, and the market. Not only it will happen fast. It took us 9-10 years to get 1 billion people to Aadhaar. It took us 5 years from launch to get UPI to 4 billion. But ONDC will happen much faster because we know the journey. We know how to make this happen. We know how to sequence the tasks. We know how to create the coalitions. We know how to create the incentives. And therefore, we will do it faster than any other transformation that we have done. ONDC will expand the market. It is not about creating an alternative. It is about expanding the market. It is about allowing more suppliers, more consumers, and more merchants, and more delivery companies all to participate. And therefore, it is going to expand the market dramatically so that more and more people can this thing. Early adopters will benefit. It is important. I remember when I used to talk to my friends in the banking sector in 2015, 2016, saying your business is going to change dramatically. They were not very convinced. And now they all say, I wish I had listened to you earlier. So this is going to happen very quickly before people know what's happening. And therefore, those who embrace it. So I really would recommend that everybody get on board now and take participate in the most exciting business transformation happening in the world. Thank you very much and all the best for ONDC. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Nandan. Thank you for your insightful comments. It's been,
thank you, Anandji.
It's been a pleasure to listen to you, and I'm sure everybody has benefited out of this. And I really hope a whole lot of people are catalyzed onto the ONDC network now. A whole lot of people must take your word and start getting integrated onto ONDC. Thank you very much for your time. And as member of the advisory council, we always have had the benefit of your sane advice. Your experience has been extremely invaluable for the journey that we have done till now. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, Anil ji.
Thank you. Now I would request the chief guest, Mr. Anurag Jain, Secretary, Department for Promotion of Industry and Internet Trade, Ministry of Commerce and India, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India, to give his address, please. Shri Anurag Jain.
Thank you, Anil ji. Respected Nandan Nilekani ji, whom I personally respect a lot and I have known him for, and from his speech you can make out we have worked together for quite some time. Aril General Bhai ji, Koshi ji, Anil Agrawal ji, and all the friends and colleagues. First of all, let me wish you all a very happy Bihu, Pongal, Lohri, Sankranti, and I mean this is a festival time in the country. So auspicious time in the country. So let me wish you that. I must also compliment the team which Mr. Nandan Nilekani has so eloquently spoken about, the advisory council and all people working together. So I consider myself fortunate to have joined this team at an appropriate time when we can make it move faster. So I compliment the whole team for having done some wonderful groundwork, which will on the basis of which we'll build the castle now and have this really exciting transformation. In fact, after Nandan Nilekani Saab's address, no other address should have been there. That's the fantastic, it should have been the end. But unfortunately, I have to speak after him. So I'll just put some thoughts into this and bring that some government perspective also. First thing I want to share is a little about a startup and, you know, Startup India Innovation Week. You all know that this program was launched in 2016 by the Honorable Prime Minister, and it is 6 years now. I think I've been repeating it in almost every part of the speech that the startup movement in India has really deepened and has taken a strong hold, even in the rural parts of the country, interior part of the country. Within just 6 years, we have more than 60,000 registered startups. We have more than we have our presence in more than 600 districts of the country. And most important part is that 45% of the startups are from tier 2 and tier 3 cities. 45% of the promoters are women. So that shows the movement really taking strong roots. What has happened? India was always known for its innovation. I know many people have written about the Jugaad technology of the country. But what was Jugaad? Jugaad is basically an innovative spirit. And what has this startup mission done? A startup mission has provided an ecosystem to a Jugaad mind to convert that Jugaad into innovation and taking it to scale and taking it to market. So I think that's a very good thing. It has been able to institutionalize and deepen the movement. And going forward, I personally feel, I mean, I must congratulate all the winners of the hackathon. I was really impressed about the kind of challenges which Janul Bhai and Koshiji and their team had thrown to the people. And I'll come to that a little later when I start talking about ONDC. But what came out very clearly is the young minds working. And I have a huge trust and confidence in the young generation of the country. I personally believe every 5 years, generation changes and younger generation is much more smart than the older generation. So the young kids which were coming, even 15-year-old people, actually Anil ji was telling me that one of the kids in another hackathon had given a concept which is very similar to ONDC. I don't know whether he knew that this thing or not, but he actually gave a fantastic example how this thing should be taken forward, which is basically more or less like the ONDC idea. And he happens to be, I think, class 8th or class 9th student in Pune. He was narrating me that. So that shows the deep understanding of the young minds in the country. So I'm sure next 25 years, as we are talking about as part of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, we are also talking about vision for the country in 2047. So these 25 years, I personally believe, are going to transform India fundamentally, and India is going to take the place of pride within these 25 years. We have the demographic advantage. We have the people, the technology bit ingrained into us, and this startup will be a prime mover for the road to prosperity for the country by 2047. So that's the thing going to happen. And so to institutionalize all this, we actually decided to institutionalize this arrangement of a startup innovation week. So every year we'll have this week now onwards to commemorate this 16th January. And around this Monday to Sunday, around 16th January is what will be the startup innovation week every year. So that it gives a platform to all the people, all the stakeholders to take the movement forward. Now this ONDC, Mr. Koshi and Nandanji has so eloquently explained the whole concept, but I'll just pick up two words from Mr. Koshi's speech: interoperability and unbundling. So they are the technical experts, so they did a better job of explaining the technical part. But what it does to my understanding, when you make it interoperable, it basically unleashes the potential of imagination and innovation. Like, you have created a protocol. Now everyone, depending on his imagination, just by adhering to those protocols, create his own vision and make the things better for the end user, maybe the retailer or the seller or whatever, or the consumer. So the whole potential of young minds gets unleashed because of the interoperability. The other point is unbundling. Unbundling as a system, we know, initially we used to talk about, when we talk about the process, the collaboration and energy is coming through collaboration. But what does the unbundling do? Unbundling breaks it up into different parts. And the technology does the collaborative part. Earlier, a company used to like everything to be done in-house so that the collaboration happens if different businesses are doing that. But that collaborative part is now being done by the platform or the technology or this open network. And what is happening now when you have unbundled something? So each part is basically something which is being done by someone who has a comparative advantage in that. So therefore, because of the unbundling and the collaborative energy of the open network, what we have a solution which is the most cost effective solution. So this is how I would like to look at from the economics or the finance point of view, what you have done as interoperable, unbundling, and open network. So that is what it is. We also have, Nandanji has already so eloquently explained the digital journey of the country in the last 7-8 years, how it has really matured. And the first building block was Aadhaar, which he himself led. And then the GEM Trinity, where I was part of it. And then I was also fortunate to be part of the journey thereafter, like UPI. At that time, I was trying to put it from the PMO side, and I used to talk to him, UPI Bheem, and then converting to digital transactions and all that. But I will just bring out two more facets. I mean, it was such an eloquent speech and covered almost everything, but two untouched facets. Like, one program was Pahal. Pahal is basically the LPG program. And other program is the Ration Card. Actually, when I was designing Jandhan, we had searched across all the various materials. One thing which I was actually piqued by looking at is a G20 statement talking about reducing the cost of remittance from 10% to 5%. I was aghast. 5%, I mean, there's an objective. Then as you all know, we have been able to do it through UPI, that it is only a 20 paisa transaction cost. So it has disrupted the whole world. I recall when we were doing Jandhan, and along with Jandhan, we had tied up Rupee. So all these masters and visas of the world came to me and said, this is something which is unethical. You can't do this. You can't mandate everybody to use the Rupee card. I said, I am just connecting my Jandhan people. Anyway, you are not going to touch these poor people. It actually took a lot of convincing the banks to open the Jandhan accounts. I mean, initially it was, there was a lot of hitch. I recall creating a model, discussing with them, and then telling them it's a business idea. It is not a charity you are going to do. Within 2-3 years, you will start having a positive impact on your banking of all this. So when this masters and visas of world came, I actually asked one of the banks where I used to be on the board to calculate the cost of transaction of a MasterCard or a Visa card. Trust me, my banker friends could not calculate, because it was so much of layering. They said, sir, how do I give you the cost of one transaction? So I said, okay, let's calculate, keep it simple. Whatever money you pay throughout the year to them on whatever account, and calculate the number of transactions. It came to a whopping 50 rupees per transaction. This was an eye-opener even for the bank, because they had never realized they take money in so many different accounts under so many different names. They had never calculated it. After that, they went to Competition Commission to lodge a complaint, and they actually reduced the average cost from 50 rupees to 8 rupees for the banks. Otherwise, most of the banks would have immediately left them when it became clear. So what I'm saying, that was kind of a disruption which happened because of that. But another more important factor was, there was an estimate that total leakage in the country in the beneficiary schemes used to be 132,000 crore. Just imagine, and this is, I am talking about 2011 or 12. I mean, this, we were designing this scheme, we started designing the scheme in 2013-14. We were able to launch when the Honorable Prime Minister gave his nod. So when we were studying, it was 2010 or 11 study, 132,000 crore. Just imagine the kind of amount which was considered as a leakage, out of which one of the biggest was Russian. With the Aadhaar authentication practice coming in, this leakage is almost gone. Very little leakage is still left. That is because of the dual pricing. If we can somehow remove that dual pricing, then even that will, the, whatever that little remains goes away. But because of the Aadhaar authentication, the most of the corruption or the most of the leakage in the Russian system has gone away. So Nandan Neelakani Saab's Aadhaar system and integrating it with the other services has actually saved that kind of money. And that 60,000 crore would have grown to about 150,000 crore by now, because the cost of grain has been continuously increasing. Similarly, on the Pahal thing, because of the Aadhaar authentication plus removing the dual pricing, the estimated leakage was around 20,000 crore. So these were the two big items. And other than that, all other items becoming DBT, directly money going to the bank accounts. So effectively, the leakage has more or less vanished. So this is a systematic way of removing corruption in the system. So that's a huge transformation which has happened because of the digital transactions and the kind of things which have happened. As for ONDC, I looked at the challenges. I think three very important things are coming in addition to what I knew about the ONDC when I saw the presentation from Mr. Koshi. One, you are talking about dynamic pricing. One, you are talking about the inventory management. One, you are talking about the optimization of delivery cost. All these facilities will actually reduce the cost of doing business for everybody. So for retailer also, so it will be a win-win situation. As basic economics says, if there is a reduction in price, the benefit will be it will be shared between the consumer and the seller both. I was also looking at it, one issue which has been actually, which is faced by the government at the policy level, is when all these big players, Amazons and Flipkarts, came up, there is always a continuous tension between the small kirana retailers and these big players. And we know that there's a huge section of people who need to be supported otherwise, because they are also, I mean, that's the social fabric of the country. We need to understand. what Mr. Koshi was showing in his presentation, that at this point of time, about 3% of the total commerce is e-commerce, and about 0.125% of the retailers are on it. So if I do a quick match, 3% by 0.125%, it shows the people who are on the e-commerce site are on an average 25 times the average. So they are only the relatively bigger players who are able to take advantage of e-commerce. That is the situation now. Even though we are talking about the success of digital platforms and success of e-commerce in the country and digital payments and everything, but still the benefit which is being taken is only the bigger retailers. The small people are still out of it, and they are still in the hyper loop kind of activity, as Nandanji said, you have to phone them up, they'll deliver it to you. But still, they are not able to access, take advantage of delivering it at a distance using a service delivery, which this ONDC will provide. So this can actually be another disruptive change, as he has already explained. I need not go into the detail. But what we need to be careful about is the change management, reaching out to these retailers, explaining them, removing their concerns, because the most important thing in these things is the change management. I recall when we were trying to popularize digital transactions, we actually allocated, one of the biggest reasons why Jan Dhan was successful is that we pinpointedly give the responsibility to somebody. The whole country was mapped into small zones, and each zone was the responsibility of some bank, which in turn was actually some branch, bank branch and the bank. So it was ensured that in that particular geography, that kind of a thing, a common service center or a bank correspondent came in. Similarly, when we were doing the digital transactions, all the big markets in the country were mapped according to their locality, like Sarojini Nagar market, Lajpat Nagar market, and Delhi, etc. These markets were mapped at the local level. It was given as a responsibility to somebody. Somebody was there who actually did reach out to those market associations, explained to them the benefits of digital transactions and how to actually access that. Just by advertisement, we may not be able to reach all of them. So that kind of interacting. Fortunately, in ONDC, another important ingredient is that we have CAT representative with us. So that's a good way to reach out to them. But we would probably need to focus on that to ensure that we are able to reach out to these people. So I am also actually excited, really excited about this journey. And I'm sure with all the people guiding it, people like all of those people who are here, I need not repeat the names, that we will be successful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your encouraging words. With your experience of implementing Jan Dhan in this country, and now you spearheading the implementation of ONDC from DPIIT, the ONDC is in absolutely safe hands. Your insights into numbers, your insights into implementation of population scale initiatives will really help us do this. And I must let this know to this audience that it was Mr. Anurag Jain who approved a project for ONDC to be scaled up in a 5-minute briefing that we gave him. And for that, he deserves all the credits. And because of which, today, that 10 crore commitment from Government of India has enabled us to get 200 crore commitment from so many other participants. Thank you very much, sir. And we are absolutely in safe hands so far as ONDC is concerned. I must thank Mr. Nandan Nilekani for sparing his valuable time. I have been after him. I said, no, you have to be there and you just can't get away in half an hour. You have to be there for 90 minutes. Thank you, Nandan, for being here. Thank you for sharing your advice. We'll keep bothering you more and more because we need your time. We need your guidance. And we can't let you be, not be free from us. So we have to be bothering you. I must thank Adil and all members of my advisory council of ONDC, whose tremendous support. And we've been calling them not just during the meetings. We've been calling them across the meetings. And it is not a board meeting. It is like an executive kind of a place where we discuss minor things over calls, morning and the evenings, and then that is how all these things are shaping up pretty fast. So my heartfelt gratitude to Adil, Anjali, Nandan, Dr. R.S. Sharma. Dr. R.S. Sharma has made tremendous contribution to the ONDC. Mr. Khandelwal, Dilip Asbe, we have Arvind Gupta, Kumar, everyone from the advisory council. And I want to mention the contribution made by Koshi and his team in the last 5 months. I mean, the way you've scaled up this entire thing is tremendous. I must compliment Koshi and your entire team at ONDC, which has, you know, brought it the way you've conducted these hackathons in December and in January. And I know we've been demanding, but that demand has been fulfilled more than that. And absolutely thankful to you for this. I must thank the Startup India team at DPIIT, my colleague Shruti and her team, Startup India team, for helping us organize these events on ONDC during the Innovation Week, for letting us this platform of Startup India for organizing the ONDC. And we are absolutely grateful to our secretary for positioning ONDC as an innovation from DPIIT to this world. Like, you know, we are celebrating Innovation Week. At Startup India, we are celebrating supporting innovation from all across the world. And here we are celebrating and supporting the innovation that has happened within DPIIT. So that is something that is absolutely gorgeous about this. I must thank all the participants who have participated in the hackathons that we have conducted. You know, you deserve those thanks for having faith in us. You deserve those thanks for your time and your commitment to us. And I'm sure what you've got in return would be something that would be very, very tangible for you. I must thank, you know, the media and all the participants who are part of this session today. And as Nandan said, the idea, ONDC is an idea whose time has come. It will not only happen, it will happen fast. And with everybody's cooperation, we are in absolutely good hands. Thanks everyone for joining in today. Thank you very, very much for this lovely session. Thank you.
Just one correction. It is not an innovation from DPIIT. It is innovation from the whole team. DPIIT is only a convener or a coordinator. Let's put it, the credit where it is due.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.